Hi.
I'm back in on one time.
It's nice to be back.
Good day?
Well, it's kind of nice to be back. The weather is pretty good. And I think this is the first session for about a month. That was our last session, and Jill's back, and he's feeling better too, so that's good. Just to let you know, the last session is going to be on May the 10th. And without any further ado, you can jump.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Hello.
Good evening. Most people are this way.
We're not really people here.
Oh, we'll pray. In the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord, be with us this evening as we share, as we grow in our faith and learn. Pray your blessing upon our gathering. Be with us, be with those who could not make it tonight, that your presence be felt in their lives, particularly any who may not be well or struggling or going through any difficulties. I pray that you continue to be with us and be our strength. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So, in relation to the fact that we are going to go to May the 10th, I'm going to look at the schedule and change a couple of topics, just so I get right to the... We promised at the beginning, way back, that I would cover some hot topics, which I've been nicely avoiding. So I'll try and get some, and I'll put that in the hopper in the last four sessions of the week. But I won't do anything that's over 350 degrees Fahrenheit. Too hot.
Just so you know, Jill, we put in the bulletin for the month of this month, what the topics are?
Yeah.
It's the whole month?
So we'll leave it? But
no, we can change them.
We can change them.
What's your bulletin deadline?
Tomorrow.
Yesterday?
Yeah.
Wednesday noon.
Okay. Oh, gosh. Okay, tonight I'll think of something and mail you first thing in the morning.
What's first thing in
the
morning tonight?
That's true. Before noon. Okay. So, and to kind of get us going on that idea, tonight's topic is about Catholic principles of morality, or moral principles from a Catholic point of view. And so, and there are some basic points or basic ideas or concepts that are kind of foundation to that. So, but before I get to that, there's a foundation underneath the foundation too, sort of the underpinning of that. And what is the greatest commandment, as Jesus said? Is the greatest commandment?
Love one another, or love God.
Love God and love your neighbor, okay? So when Jesus talked about loving God and loving your neighbor, he basically, tonight I was at Roland's. Where'd you go? Oh, there you are. I was at Roland's. And after supper, we had this interesting conversation about juicing, about getting juiced, about making juice.
Only at Roland's place.
Yeah.
And
who drove?
So you have the juicing machine, right? And you put the apples and whatever else in there, and the pulp is removed, and what's left is just the liquid, and no pits, nothing, right? And so the same thing when you boil it all down, when Jesus said, when you take the Ten Commandments and you boil them down, they come to two commandments. Love God. Those are the first three commandments. And love your neighbor. Those are the last seven commandments. That the reason why we live morally is because living morally is how we love our neighbor. It's authentic love. Love that's selfish is what we would call sin, when it's turned in on ourselves, when it's egocentric or selfish. And love that gives to the other, that's a virtue. That's living in God's way. So that kind of boils down all of morality if we put it in that way. So when we think of something, we look at, does it turn in on itself, or does it go out to the other? And that's kind of how we would look at it. So as Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law, he means the Old Testament, the Torah, and the prophets. Both the law is the Ten Commandments and the prophets. So on these two commandments depend the teaching of the Bible, or the Old Testament, from Jesus' point of view. Another way to think about morality is from something that St. Leo the Great, St. Leo was a pope in, I think in the 1200s, or maybe before, around the year 1000. Anyway, about 1,000 years ago he was pope. And at the beginning of the section on morality in the Catechism, they put this quote in there to remind us again of a foundation. He's a Christian. Recognize your dignity. And now that you share in God's own nature, he's talking to people that are newly baptized, by the way, do not return to your former base condition by sinning. Remember who is your head and of whose body you are a member. Never forget that you have been rescued from the power of darkness and brought into the light of the kingdom of God. And so morality is a call to recognize our dignity or our value as men and women who have received a free gift of new life in Christ. And so we must live that new life accordingly. So I'll add also, from my own point of view, the church has always thought that being a Christian isn't just about accepting a list of doctrines or beliefs. Not just accepting that you believe in the Trinity, or you believe in the Eucharist, or you believe in this belief or that belief. But included in that is a way of living, or included in that is morality. That living a certain way, living what's right, and not living what's wrong, has always been, from the very earliest days of the church, the Christian writings always called people who converted to Christianity to live according to the commandments, to live according to certain moral principles. And so we can't separate out Christian belief and Christian practice. A lot of times we'll talk about someone who is faithful to the church's teaching. We would say they are what? The word starts with the letter O. They are
Orthodox.
Huh?
Orthodox.
Orthodox, right? The word orthodox means right teaching. Orthodoxy, right teaching. Okay? But orthodoxy also has to be combined with what's called orthopraxy, right living. So orthodoxy is, my beliefs are right, but it's also orthopraxy that I need. That my behavior has to be right. In other words, I have to practice what I preach. I can't just say I believe something, but I have to live it out. Not that we live it out perfectly, because we don't. We are sinners, and we fail, but we have to at least say we're aiming for this right way of living. And so that's done, though, and we can't live this out without grace. There was a priest whose name was Pelagius, who said that you could be good enough for God on your own. But they called what he taught Pelagianism, and the church said that isn't true. That's a fancy way of saying the church taught that was a heresy. Pelagianism is not part of Christianity. It's this idea that I can be good enough, that I don't need salvation, I don't need God's grace, I don't need God's help, I don't need a savior. We do need a savior. And so we need God's grace to help us to live a Christian life. We need God's grace to live virtue. And I think that's very important. Sometimes when we look at hot topics or whatever issues, when we look at living the commandments, whether it's not committing adultery or not lying or being a person of integrity or whatever, when we look at that, we can tend to boil it down to a legalistic way of living. And it's important that we don't slip into legalism, because then it becomes just a dry, dead obedience. We become basically what we see in the Bible, like the Pharisees, where the rule becomes more important than the person. Last week, the Pope came out with a post-synodical apostolic exhortation, which is kind of like an encyclical, only a different kind of document. And I think his core message is again to remind us that we're called to follow the commandments, we're called to follow the church's teaching, but it has to be applied with much compassion, with much mercy, and with much love. And I think that that's important, because otherwise we can turn into wizened Pharisees. And so that, to me, he brings a balance. He brings an added spice that helps us to remember the attitude in which we approach morality. How exactly that's to be lived out, we still have to work on some of the exact details on that, and he doesn't go clear on that yet, but it's just the beginning of the conversation of how do we take what we believe and how to help people move in that direction. Not that we change what we believe, but we have to at least be gentle and compassionate in applying it. And I think that's very, very good, because to me that's what the New Testament teaches. And clearly it's what Jesus taught. You know, that people, when their donkey would fall into a well on the Sabbath, they would go and take the donkey out. But if someone healed the sick on the Sabbath, they'd get all upset. Say, well, what's more important, helping a donkey or helping a human being? So we have to remember that the people are important. So that's kind of what Christian morality, Catholic morality is all about. So I'm going to talk about tonight, 5 foundation stones, or 5 foundation pieces that deal with Catholic moral theology. First is freedom. God creates us in the state of freedom. We are at liberty to choose, based on reason and will, whether to act or not act in a specific situation. And in that way, when we are free, we are responsible for our decisions. And with these decisions, we choose our ultimate reality, right? Where we're going to go for eternity, that decision is ours to make. Whether we're with the Lord or we're not with the Lord, that's the ultimate free choice that a human being has. Otherwise, we're robots. We don't have that freedom. So freedom is important in morality. For example, when clergy interview a young married couple, part of our conversation with them is, are they free to marry? Are they doing this freely? Free to marry in one sense of, are they married to someone else still? Because that would be a major impediment. Last time I checked, it still is a major impediment. We're not polygamous, you know? Maybe sequentially, but not at the same time, you know? So we try to avoid any kind of polygamy or bigamy or any kind of thing. Even monogamy is too much for me, but, you know, some people are into that. So so at least one spouse at any one time. So, but freedom also, even if they've never been married, is there any pressure to get married, for example? Are they under any kind of pressure?
Yeah.
is there any kind of, you know, natural occurrence that might pressure them to get married, right? Is there an imaginary gun to their head? And say, you know what? Maybe have the baby first, and then think about whether you want to stay with that schmuck or not, right? Because it doesn't have to be a life sentence, right? And it, you do it with maturity. But again, when we're talking about moral decisions, we're talking about human beings with free will. And so something falls under the category of morality if it's a behavior that we are free to do or not. Okay? So for example, we're all blinking. Blinking doesn't fall in the moral category at all because it's not a free act. It's an autonomic thingy, right? It's an instinctive thing. And so it doesn't, it's not immoral, but it's not an action that falls under moral theology. It's not an action that falls under whether it's right or wrong according to the Ten Commandments. But if I go in my car and I turn my car on, right, and I make a decision to run over you, okay, that's a decision I can make. Now, whether that decision is a good decision, a bad decision, can depend on all kinds of factors, right? But obviously, I have the freedom to make a decision like that. Because I am not coerced, I'm not forced to do that, and therefore I'm morally responsible for what I do when it's something that is done without any kind of outside coercion. That makes sense? So someone could do something wrong, but they may not be morally responsible if they're lacking a freedom to do it. If there's some kind of pressure or coercion, they might lose their guilt or reduce it, you know. They can't. If someone feels some kind of, like, you know, I have to go and steal this money from the bank or someone's going to kill my child, are they 100% morally responsible for robbing the bank? No, because they're under stress. They're under this pressure, right? And the catechism would bear that out, right? So that person isn't entirely responsible. The person with the gun is, right? Doesn't mean they can't make, there's some responsibility, doesn't take it all away. In some, there might be a case where it does, but in other cases, it you know, you might be 80% responsible or 5% responsible, depending on the circumstances. But for something to be, for me to be the one morally responsible for that action, I have to be free to either act or not act. That makes me the moral agent in that. So freedom is an important concept in Catholic moral thinking because of human free will. If we were all robots, like when a dog bites somebody, okay, the dog isn't acting in a moral or immoral way. It's just acting on instinct. A dog doesn't know right from wrong. It just acts. And so, because a human being can reason, can think, should I bite that person or not? You know, when I was, you know, 3, and my mom says, you're not supposed to bite your sister, right? Then you learn that you don't do that, right? And then you know after that by thinking, don't bite that person. Right? So, the freedom. Any questions on that? Does that make sense? Okay. Second principle for Catholic morality is truth. Truth. So Catholicism believes, teaches, preaches, professes that morality is based on a truth. Okay? Or It's objective. Objective. Okay? An objective means it's outside of me. It's not relativistic. It's objective. And so some of that, and further down I'll explain where it comes from, but that the fundamental thinking is that the morality is based on objective truth. And objective truth is a constant. Now, whether we know something can grow and develop, even if you look at the Bible, as the centuries roll down through from the beginning of the Bible down to the New Testament, all the way through to the New Testament, people can grow in understanding what the objective truth is. But once you find it, you realize that that didn't change. Just because I know it today and I didn't know it yesterday doesn't mean it wasn't true yesterday. It just means I didn't know it. Make sense? But that morality is based on objective truth. So it's not just a matter of taste or opinion. It's always valid. And that the ultimate source of objective truth is God himself. That he is the one that reveals his objective truth to us. So that's why probably today Catholic beliefs seem at odds with a lot of beliefs in society, because society is more relativistic now and much more subjective, where it's based on what's inside of me that I determine what's right or wrong, rather than something that's outside of myself that determines what's right or wrong. Whether you are a subjectivist, that you believe that morality is based on the inside of the person, and that everybody's inside, of course, is different, or it's based on something that is outside of me. Objective truth. Now, of course, a Catholic and maybe someone of another faith can both believe that there is such a thing as objective truth, but then they could still fight over whether a particular belief is objectively true or false. That's a separate question, right? So you might say XYZ is objectively true. Someone else might say, no, that's not objectively true. But both might believe in the concept of objective truth. There are certain things that in Catholicism are immoral that are not seen as immoral, let's say, to a Baptist. And a Baptist would probably believe certain things, well, like contraception, for example, is not seen as immoral to a Baptist, but is seen as immoral to a Catholic. And so, but both a Catholic and a Baptist would agree that there's such a thing as objective truth. So then we have to take another step of where do we get the content of our objective truth? Where do we get it from? Does that make sense? So first is an acceptance of a concept of objective truth. So the first difference is between those that believe in objective truth and those that believe in subjective truth. Once we've accepted objective truth, who has the truth about what's objectively true? That's the next question, right? You get me, philosophy students?
Yeah.
Okay, did I lose you?
Not yet.
Okay. So if you're a subjectivist, we've already lost you. Okay? But if you believe in objective truth, you can still follow along. All right. Or at least you can still agree with us on that part. So this is where we come to find the content of objective truth in Catholic theology, and Catholic teaching. First is natural law, the next pillar. The idea of natural law is even in the New Testament, where Paul talks about the people who were not who did not receive divine revelation, who were not Jewish, they were pagans, they were Gentiles, right? Who lived, you know, in Greece and Turkey and whatever, but said, you know, but inside of these Gentiles, inside of these non-Jews and non-Christians, there still was within them an innate sense of right and wrong. Most of us believe, as human beings around the world and down through history, believe that killing is wrong. There's a fundamental response to killing. It seems like a bad idea. And most of us would agree that someone who thinks killing is fun, that there is a psychological problem that they have. So that kind of concept is common. Now, some cultures might approve of certain types of killing, human sacrifices in some cultures, or going to war in other cultures, or this or that might be exceptions, but there's a general human common feeling about killing. And a whole host of other things, that there are general sense of right and wrong. Sometimes the details are different, but there is a natural law. There is that instinct to know right and wrong, and that there's a content to natural law, that even nature itself speaks the truth. Even when we talk about theology of the body, John Paul II taught that the body itself speaks a truth. The body itself speaks a theology, it speaks a message, that there is a message to nature. And so in Catholic thinking, and again, I'm not a big expert on it, right? So I'm just teaching you the little that I know. But in Catholic thinking, natural law is a touch point that Catholics feel that we can share in common with most people on the earth. That we can share these common values with other people of other religions or of no religion whatsoever, that there is a common foundation to this natural law. There's a sense of that we can see that in human beings there is a good there. There are elements of good there.
We used to call those the universal laws of mankind or humankind.
That kind of thing, yeah. Yes. And so there are things that you can see in every culture, or you might encounter a culture that's very isolated and has no contact with anybody outside. Mm-hmm. And so there's no influence from anybody else, and you look at them and you see, okay, there is a sense of conscience. There is a sense of right and wrong. There's a sense of what's appropriate, what's not appropriate. Again, certain details might be different, but that basic movement to, you know, behaving, you know, every mom in the world always says to their kid, you know, you don't poke your sister in the eye, right? So there's that sense of right and wrong. So, natural law. Any questions on that?
Is there not a shift lately to being a little bit more liberal in natural laws, and talking about a global shift? Euthanasia is just one example that crops up in my mind, where we're seeing countries...
The thing is that I think what is natural law and what we teach ourselves can be different.
Yeah, but...
Because we can train ourselves to think differently than what might be innate like if you take a primitive society without any outside influence and no television or any of that kind of thing, what would be natural to them, and what would be their instinct to live, you know? And I think that those basic things are there. I can be taught other things. It's the mixture between what's innate to us and what we learn as well. Does that make sense?
Well, like one of the universal laws is to treat elders with respect. And I think we were talking about the laws of euthanasia. So you treat your elders with respect up to a point, and then get them out of their misery.
But see, natural law is like a... it has a certain place, right? But natural law needs help. Because it's not perfect. It's just a recognition that there is a, like, when Pelagius was talking about the fact that one could be good outside of grace and still get to heaven, there was an element of truth that there is a goodness in people who are outside the church. But there isn't the fullness of truth, right? And that doesn't, you can acknowledge that without saying that's the whole package, right? And that if you study human cultures, you will find elements that are common to the Ten Commandments in other cultures. And that common ground is what we would call, as far as I understand natural law, natural law. And this, again, is all based on how much, on what I understand it to be, not having a PhD in natural law. Okay, so that's the next, that's the third. So first is freedom, then it's truth, then it's natural law. What time is the break again?
8:00.
8:00, okay. Okay. On my list here, I boosted this article from the internet. Again, I'm not an expert, so I had to steal it. Kind of immoral, isn't it? I'll reference the site later. The next one, it says law, but I'm changing the word because it's not law in the legal sense. It's the commandments. Okay. So the part that if natural law is here, the part that builds on natural law is the commandments, or what we would call divine revelation. It's God saying to us, don't do that, or do that. It's the added part that we wouldn't know if there was no burning bush, or if there was no Jesus. That's natural law. Without Jesus, without the burning bush, without Moses, and that whole tradition, without that experience and encounter with God, the God of Israel, and the God of Jesus in this, that's the same one, by the way, and this revealing himself, so that what Plato and Aristotle would have had simply natural law, not revelation. But what the believer has with basically the Bible, when we say the Bible, not just the pages, but the experience of those people, the experience of the people of Israel in the Old Testament and then the apostles and early church in the New Testament, is this belief that God revealed himself to a people and said, this is how I want you to live. And so natural law takes us so far, and then revealed law, the Torah, the gospel, the revealed law takes us the rest of the way. So we learn, we take in so much as natural human beings, and then we need that supernatural help to know the rest of it. And that's the commandments, or we could say, and by revelation, I don't just mean the book, the one book of the Bible, yeah. But like Moses in the burning bush and receiving the Ten Commandments from God, that's a revelation, right? That's God saying, thou shalt not kill. And revelation includes in all of that all of the thinking of 2,000 years of how to apply that. So revelation, it's included with, obviously for us as Catholics, scripture and
tradition,
right? And this would be true for Jews as well, right? Because, you know, I saw Fiddler on the Roof. And and actually, Catholicism and Judaism both have a sense of tradition, and meaning the same thing. The content is different, Jewish tradition being different than Catholic tradition, but if you read, you know, the Midrash or the Talmud and the different writings like that, of course, that's a content of Jewish way of interpreting scripture, which is tradition. And then, of course, in Catholicism, we have a Catholic way of interpreting scripture. Some of it overlaps, of course, especially when it comes to certain things in the Old Testament. But again, this is how we view what we've got from God. And so this specifically helps us to receive the information that how do we live the moral life. We get it from not just I think or I feel that this it's this way or that way, but that I've received this information from someone who knows more than I do, from God himself. Now, this of course takes what? To accept this?
Faith.
Faith, right? If I don't believe that this is from God, the Bible's just a made-up book, then of course I may or may not take any of this, and it may or may not be of any importance to me, right? So this presupposes, again, that I'm going to accept and believe the content of this God going, peekaboo, here I am. And the owner being God, the manufacturer being God, saying, here's the handbook. This is how you take care of your yourself, right? So when I bought the car, I got a book with the car. I don't know, you still get books with new cars, or do they give you an app now or something? I don't know what they do now. My car is like 12 years old, so maybe now there's an app. But nonetheless, they probably give me instructions, right? Huh? Yeah, probably. And so the book obviously would say what kind of oil I should use and what the tire pressure should be and other things that I don't know about cars. You know, it'll tell me those kinds of things that we need to know. And if I don't follow those instructions, you know, I want to put Chardonnay in my gas tank, right? Oh, it's nice, beautiful stuff, right? It's delicious, right? But the car doesn't know that. And it might get the car so far, but maybe not all the way. But certainly not if I put, let's say, milk in the gas tank.
Or diesel.
Or the wrong kind of thing, right? Because again, oh, you did that.
Been there.
Went about half a mile.
So again, what does having faith helps me take the natural law and bring it to the this level here, depending where you're going, a higher level or a deeper level, whatever, but to another level of saying, I need something more than just my natural instincts to tell me what's right and what's wrong. Part of the reason why this is important is the human tendency for self-deception. We all contend to deceive ourselves as to whether, or not, in other words, we rationalize what we're doing, right? And if I'm my own Moses, right, I can make excuses for my behavior and I can say what I want to do is right and no one can tell me otherwise. And so what rationalization, or maybe that's not the right word, but what criteria do I use to show that there is an, like, I guess it's part of my own temperament is that I instinctively believe, maybe that sounds funny, but I think I subjectively believe that there's an objective truth. Like deep inside myself, I really believe that I can't just make up my own morality. Because if I did, well, I'd probably be dead by now because I'd be doing all kinds of things that probably would kill me. But I believe, okay, if the manufacturer, God says, this is how you are to live, to be the Matthew Kelly thing, the best version of yourselves. Right? As corny as that expression gets after I hear it 1,000 times, say it, but it's still true. And it puts it in regular English rather than say to be a saint or to be holy. But it really is the best way that I can live is the optimal use of the car is to do thus and so and change the oil at certain times and to keep it clean and all of this stuff and da-da. How do I take care of me, my soul or my body or whatever? What do I do for optimal, efficient use of me? That I have stewardship over this. How do I live? And so that's where the commandments come in. That I live according to the law of the Lord. Because when I live according to the law of the Lord, I live within that everything's working properly. Because everything is all in its right place. Right? Just like in the car, you know, the oil is where the oil is supposed to be, and the washer fluid is where the washer fluid is supposed to be, and all the gears and all the parts and all the wires and all the doohickeys and thingamajigs are all where they're supposed to be. I can use the car properly. It can roll. It can do things. And so the same thing is true when we look at God has He's shown us his way. And say, you follow this way and you'll be good. Because I make a you. I make a you, you follow me, you work good. You know? A couple weeks ago I went to the optometrist, right? I got new glasses and all of a sudden everything looks so much better because now my eyes have the right lens for me to see. Now I've reached that milestone in life. I have progressives now. I'm in my 50s. It's happening. And death is just around the corner. Anyway, it's coming. It's coming for me.
You're halfway there.
Yeah. All right. Now, before we go to the break, I want to talk about the last part before we do the Q&A section. So, we get all of that?
Yeah.
Does that make a sense? And all of those components of freedom, of truth, of natural law, and law or commandments of God's law, they all have a role to play, including this last part. The last part is conscience. We use our natural faculty facility called conscience. No, I think that should be faculty. To apply the general principles of the law, of the commandments or of the rules, right, to specific situations, judging specific actions to be right or wrong in accordance with objective law. Conscience is not the source of those moral principles. So again, we can deceive ourselves. So that's why consciences must be well formed. That doesn't mean that everyone's conscience, let's say everyone, you have a room full of all committed Catholics, all who share the same faith, all who share the same values, that their consciences are all exactly the same. Because we have different temperaments, because we have different tolerances for different things, that some of us might find certain things maybe more difficult than others. And so you can tailor sometimes things for personal application. Let me give you just a little example of that. For example, you take a movie like Lord of the Rings, take the trilogy, for example. Right? Now, you have a parent. You have a child, let's say, about 12 years old. Some parents might say, you know what? I know that my son or my daughter is very sensitive to violent scenes. Now, I'm not saying there's a moral objection to Lord of the Rings, written by a good Catholic man, blah, 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 all that stuff. But for someone who might be at a young age, it might be more than that person can take. Another parent might say, well, I know my kid, you know, and they could watch it and it won't faze them. And you see how the same information, a different conscience, for that person, that particular thing might not be appropriate because that person might find it difficult. That's not relativism in the objective sense. It's you have to adapt certain things to say, for that kid, they might need to wait till they're 16 to see that movie. Or maybe some people don't like violence and they'll never see the movie because it's too much and they're too squeamish or whatever. And that's a personal conscience thing. That's not objective. So for example, and sometimes it's good to know the difference between objective and my own personal preference that is, you know, in a small way, a moral difference between me and someone else, but that's just my own. And sometimes people confuse that, right? That, let's say, if I say that I don't like, you know, country music, right? I can't preach from the pulpit that country music is from the devil, right? Because where does that opinion come from? Does it come from somehow some objective data? Is there a department in the Vatican that teaches me that this is of the devil? Right? Where am I getting that information from? Right? So I can't use a personal thing to make a universal, but I can take a universal thing and apply it to a specific situation. And that's where conscience can help us. To say, based on specific circumstances, something might go this way or that way, because there's some options there. Some things obviously are always wrong, and you can never choose to do, and you can't, you know. It's like, it's not like adultery is okay for some people and not okay for other people. No, that's always going to be objectively wrong. But when you have something that's, you know, morally neutral, you know, a movie that's decent, some people might find it difficult, some people might not. But again, that's again based on a personal conscience. And conscience has to wrestle with that. Does that make sense? Any questions on that? And so, for example, you know, we all know, even when we were kids, you know, so-and-so's parents, they let their kids stay up half an hour later than our parents. Right? Those are decisions that can be made at the parent level that they're not based on, there's no divine revelation that says thou shalt go to bed at 10 o'clock, right? So the parents make the best prudential judgment based on their conscience. And there can be some variety. That again doesn't make it relativism, but you have to apply universal norms or general principles of, okay, well my universal principle is I have to be a good parent. Well, how am I a good parent as me and with that child? Because different children need different rules, as you know, which I don't know, but people tell me they do. You know. So, does that make sense? And so that conscience is like that, the ability to take those universal principles and how do I apply that in this situation to the best of my ability, always assuming we have the best. Okay, so we'll take a break now. And yeah, want to get through the five, which I did. So we're good.
Excellent.
Oh, I love hearing that.
Oh, I miss you, Kemi.
A famous cookie.
I hope you asked, like,
got to be one in there from Jacques.
Those are all very good reactions.
Okay.
Class dismissed.
One of my, I teach ours on Thursday nights, I do RCIA at Holy Cross, my home parish. I don't teach every week, but I'm the leader of it. We take turns, but one of the ladies that was just received into the church, she said one of the things she appreciated is when she'd ask a question and I said I didn't know. She liked that honesty. And I might say that answer a couple times.
Chicken.
First question. Focusing on doing good works, being a good person, is often used by non-church goers or atheists. Sometimes that's the same. Mm-hmm. Not too many atheists go to church, but you never know. As an excuse for not going to church or for believing in God. How can we counter such an argument? It's also related to how sometimes Protestants view Catholics. That they see Catholics or Catholicism as a religion that believes you're saved only by your good works. Is your joint declaration coming in there? That isn't true. Not to minimize the good works that people do. There are many, 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 like a lot, of very good, ethical, moral people who are not believers. Some so good, so ethical, they can put a lot of believers to shame. Right? Mm-hmm. Some more generous, some kinder, etc., etc., etc. Now, not my place, or anyone else's, I think, to judge them. I can't judge how God will take care of them, or what happens to their soul after they die. We believe in the mercy of God, and we hope for the mercy of God. But the ordinary means of salvation is to enter into a relationship with Jesus Christ. We are not saved by how good we are. We're not at all saved by how impressed God is with how much money we've given to charity, with how kind we are and how many little old ladies we help cross the street. Those are all good things, wonderful things. And even in a non-believer, there can be moments where God's grace somehow peeks through the crack. Right? Of course. But God's grace can come through someone who doesn't know the gospel, and God will judge them according to the light that they have. And so good works are that. They're good. They're not evil. A good deed is a good deed is a good deed. But in Christian theology, the salvation comes from living in a relationship with Jesus Christ. The Christian who has faith in Jesus does good works not to impress God, but as a fruit of their faith. That I want to imitate Jesus. And some Christians do that very well. Some Christians don't do that very well. And again, the ultimate judge is God, is whether there are Christians who should know better, and that's orthodoxy, should live better, orthopraxy, and are ultimately going to be responsible before God for their lack of good behavior, or their sinfulness, as we say. You know? Dante, in his, you know, famous poem, put quite a few clergy, and usually if you get to the level of clergy, you're supposed to be a Christian, you know. So there's, you know, I don't think he put any deacons in hell. But, you know, there's a couple popes. There's a couple popes there. And so you can even be ordained and lose your soul. So again, a good works has a role to play, of course. But the more important thing, at least I would say, is our relationship with God. And only God can judge someone else's relationship with God. If someone passes away who you don't think was a believer. It's why we pray in one of the Eucharistic prayers, right? We pray for those whose faith is known to God alone. Right? So, I can't know what's in someone else's head. Right? Even if they say they tell me, that doesn't really tell me. I can guess. So what do I say to the person who says, well, my church is the forest? Well, first of all, do you go every Sunday morning at 10 o'clock into the forest? I think that's just an excuse, because probably they're sleeping in. Can God speak to people outside of the church? Yes. Can God's grace work outside the sacraments? Yes. But do we know God's grace works in the sacraments? Yes. Is the ordinary way that God works is through the sacraments? Yes. Are the sacraments a means to help us grow in grace? Yes. So it's not just to talk about the absence of God in their life for not going to church or participating in the sacraments. But it's how much more of the presence of God that they can receive by entering into a faithful, devout, sacramental life. It's a call to conversion, and even not just to ritual, but to a relationship with Jesus Christ. The purpose of being a Christian is my life has changed because I've encountered Jesus, and I want to drag as many people as I can to heaven with me by having that same encounter with Jesus Christ. So to me, the whole purpose of countering the argument or of evangelism, of sharing the gospel, is by sharing with people the relationship with Jesus. Even before morality, the starting point is a relationship with Jesus. That's, to me, the first and foremost thing. The most important thing is to bring them to that. Can a person outside have some connection with God or spiritual things and be good and decent? Sure. And can we praise those good things? Yes. But can they be much more? The Christian would say, yes, they can be much more. Doesn't take away the reality of there being bad Christians. Lots of those too. And in the end, God's going to sort all that out. But I think if you can go from being a good atheist to a good Christian, you've improved. Being a Christian, that's my bias, I believe that's a step up. Because there you encounter the grace of Jesus Christ, you encounter the Lord in a much more profound way, your spiritual life is augmented by that when there's an authentic conversion involved. Does that make sense? And so it's to help people to say, you know what? Sure, even a nun can find God in the forest, right? She can go and on retreat and walk through, you know, nature and find, you know, the Pope has a garden, you know, in the Vatican there. He walks through and sees the trees and all that. Of course, everybody can find God there. You know, that's again part of what's innate in us. Next question. What are some examples of natural law? Well, I think I said, like, this idea of bumping off people as an example. Just a basic morality, like, a mom cares for a baby. Just human. Human things. I don't know if anyone else has. I can't think of a specific...
Respect for children who are going to be our future. Respect for elders. Showing kindness and compassion to those who are ill. Just a few others. Can't think off the top of my head, but just basic human dignity and respect.
It's just those, I think we would say there are those things that are, that we find common, that basic morality that is underneath the Ten Commandments, that humans, when we go to other cultures, we say, oh, there are some values that are universal.
When it comes to marriage, can we say there's a connection with natural law in marriage?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, you tell me how.
Okay, a man and a woman unite
to
make a family.
Different cultures have polygamy, right? And different variations. But that fundamental concept from the dawn of time, that marriage meant a certain thing, right? And so that's part of what we would say is natural law. Because the boy meets the girl, and together they make a family. That's how we got here in the first place, right? And then before, in everybody's first place, right? And so there's, again, this common human experience creates that bond. Again, some of the details are different. But there is underneath that a fundamental concept of that relationship. The fundamental concept of parenting, right? There's a fundamental concept of, but those basic moral codes are in there, but the content needs to be updated or upgraded with divine revelation. But the basic core or the basic hardware is kind of inside all of us, or most of us, right? Unless you're psychopathic or something, or sociopathic. Then there's no, the hardware isn't there, right? But the basic hardware is what the church said. I'd have to study more about exact thing. That's why I said I wasn't a big expert on that. But I think that's kind of the example of what I mean. Next question.
Slice or a duck.
That's my answer. Why did all cultures not receive revelation? I don't know. I don't know. You know, I know a friend asked me, well, what makes Israel so special? What makes them so special that they get the God and all that and no one else did? I can't answer that question. I'm not God. I didn't do it. You know? It's a good question. But the answer, I don't know. You know, like, why not the Chinese, or why not the people in Burma, or why not the people in wherever? Everybody got a little something, but they got the most. You know, there was something about Abraham that impressed God. You know, I don't know. It's a good question. Now, there are those who believe that that's false, that there's nothing special, that everybody is the same. You know, but Judeo-Christian belief in revelation of that says otherwise, that there is something unique. But why? I don't know. As Tevye said in Fiddler on the Roof, I know we're your chosen people, but once in a while, could you choose somebody else? But it is a good question. Now, the Christian tack on that is that covenant that was given to Israel, that unique covenant to that people, is opened up to every race and tribe and culture through Jesus Christ. That's why Christianity is a religion that evangelizes, because we get grafted into the covenant of Israel through Christ. That's what the New Testament is all about. Right? That Jewish covenant now is extended to all the Gentiles. But again, to those outside of Christianity would still say that that still claims a Christian exclusivism. Mm. Right? Because we are the ones that bring the truth. Right? So again, that sounds arrogant. Sometimes it was treated arrogantly or done arrogantly, but I don't think it's meant to be done in an arrogant way. But there is that understanding that we have received in Christ God himself, and we're called to share that message with everyone. But why? But I think every culture did receive some. Because like Vatican II teaches, right, that there's a light of truth in every culture. There are lights here and there, little tea lights all over the place, right? But the big Easter candle, we know where that is, right? Next question. Why is relativism such a dangerous thing, as Pope Benedict said? Well, number one, because Pope Benedict said so. <That's it. coughs> And because... Here's my understanding of why relativism is not the best. Because everybody can't have a green light at the same time. If there's a green light, there has to be a red light. Relativism, in my mind anyway, says that everybody gets to go at the same time. And we're going to bump into each other, and there's no, it's chaos. Right? Because you can't have opposites true. So it makes getting along difficult when everything is relative. I'm trying to think of an example. Take, for example, okay, the case of the Little Sisters of the Poor in the U.S., okay, where in their conscience, okay, they, because of the healthcare system in the U.S., they have to provide healthcare for their employees, okay, great, but part of it includes the funding for contraception and, I think, abortion, that these sisters can't, in conscience, support financially. There is no provision in the law to give them an exemption to just pay for what they can support and still follow the healthcare system. Okay. Now, I personally believe, without being too partisan, that the general principles of wanting universal healthcare, I'm a Canadian, anybody on YouTube who's watching in the U.S., so I don't mind that at all, okay? I'm not that far to the right, you know? But at the same time, there has to be a provision for conscience. Here in Canada, we have this whole thing with euthanasia, and there's a debate, and there's even the movement to even exclude the freedom of conscience that doctors can opt out of recommending people who will provide euthanasia. Because if it goes against my conscience, if euthanasia goes against my conscience, it would go against my conscience to recommend you to a doctor who will euthanize you. Right? Well, under the system of relativism, it wouldn't work, would it? Because if relativism becomes an absolute, then it becomes dictatorial, as Pope Benedict says, the dictatorship of relativism. And so then there's no freedom of conscience. We end up then with a battle of, well, whose conscience gets to impose itself on everybody else, right? Does the right impose itself on the left or the left on the right or whatever analogy you want to use, whatever. And it's it's this battle that happens. And that's why, well, relativism can't work because two opposite things can't both be right. It's either okay to, you know, inject someone with a deadly chemical or whatever so that they pass away, or it's not. Abortion. You can't give half an abortion. You can't. You can't compromise. Like when you're talking politics, a politician, you know, on the right will want small government, right? And on the left they want big government. So when they get elected and if they have kind of a coalition type of thing, they'd say, okay, we'll have a medium-sized government, you know. We'll go from, let's say, 10% tax to 50% tax, so we'll compromise at 25%. Right? That's politics, right? You kind of, okay. But with moral issues, it becomes a challenge because how do you solve that? And so that to me is my concern with relativism, is that it, because if it's based on a subjective feeling,
emotions.
How do you, well, not just emotions, but I think, on the subjective thinking.
Does it become like a popular opinion?
Well, not just that, but then I have no external thing to help me, to guide me, right? Because again, I think there's an inherent human nature for me to deceive myself, or for us to deceive ourselves. And so we believe that there is an objective data. That's why we create laws in the first place, is to help us live as a society. And so, to the best of my understanding, relativism can cause rather than a symphony of different things, different instruments all playing the same tune together, you end up with a really bad high school band practice. That's like everything squeaking and going in all kinds of different directions because everybody becomes their own lord, right? And there's no, how do you, that's my thing. It looks chaotic to me and it's disharmonious because we're not plugged into the right thing. Does that make sense? Or at least did I present it clearly-ish? Yeah. I'm not Pope Benedict, so I can't speak like he does, because he uses big words in long sentences and very precise terminology, because he's a deep thinker. Right? Any questions from the? Oh, good.
Nothing to do with tonight's topic.
Oh,
Mexicans love to talk about the Day of the Dead. Where do Christians have that? What do we have that? You ever heard of it?
Yeah. The Day of the Dead in Mexico, I think has, if I remember from my tourist book, having been in Mexico, the Day of the Dead is also connected with All Souls Day.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
But there was a pre-Christian concept of the Day of the Dead before your Christianity came to Mexico. And so some of the pre-Christian and post-Christian ideas are a little bit mixed. It happened in Europe too, where there were, you know, Christmas trees in the house was kind of a pagan thing, and we kind of Christianized it. The Day of the Dead, as a Christian concept or as a Catholic concept, is a day to pray for the dead.
Right.
Now, whether they take the excesses and worship the dead or whatever, that would be inappropriate for a Christian, but some of that is a holdover from the pre-Christian era. Some of the customs that they do. Yeah.
See the Book of Life, that's what he's talking about.
Hmm?
The Book of Life, this movie, The Book of Life, has the Day of the Dead.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and in Mexico they celebrate that.
Yeah.
But, and the best way to celebrate, you know, the most optimistic way to look at it is, for the Christian, is All Souls Day. and pray for those who've died. But some of it has, you know, walking around, like, kind of Halloween-ish, skeletons and stuff like that from the little I read in the tourist book. There's excessive, you know, there can be Christian excesses too, like on Good Friday when in the Philippines they crucify people.
Yeah. Or Mardi Gras?
Well, Mardi Gras is an obsession.
Mardi Gras Christian? Really?
Well, sort of.
Sort of.
It's a pre-Lent, like, it's a...
You stuff your face.
Yeah, you stuff your face. But it also means you indulge in all kinds of things before you fast during Lent, right? So it got to be a bit exaggerated.
Yeah.
But even, you know, in terms of religious things, you know, when you do passion plays or real crucifixions, that's, you know, absurd. So I'm not saying that Christians aren't excessive inappropriately too, right? We all have our things. But yeah, the Day of the Dead has some pre-Christian influence or pagan influence, but some of that is, you know, is linked with Catholicism too.
You made our eyebrows go like this when you say passion plays that have...
In the Philippines, they'll do passion plays,
yeah,
and the guy playing Jesus will really be crucified to the cross.
And they have a path that you can walk as well, where multiple people will crucify themselves because they believe it gets them closer to Jesus.
They get very literal with that.
Yeah.
The church condemns it, but they do it anyway.
They don't die, do they?
No, not always. But once in a while,
once in a while, yeah.
Accidents happen. People accidentally
die.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it happens because their devotion gets a little carried away.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's it for questions.
Catholics believe euthanasia is wrong, right?
Correct.
So even though you feel sorry for the people and you have a feeling that you're hurting them by letting them live, it would be kinder to end their suffering in their life. That's not the right feeling to have. Or it's the right feeling to have, just to act on it is wrong.
I think that compassion is compassion, mm-hmm, right? It would be a misguided compassion to end someone's life. Catholic teaching does say that, for example, and if you want me to do euthanasia as a hot topic, I can. I have to read a lot to get that in, because again, I'm not a super expert on it. But what I do know, I'll say very briefly, for example, let's say you have someone who is in the hospital. They're in pain. Doctor comes to you and says, I have a painkiller. With this painkiller, that patient will live 1 month. With the disease, without the painkiller, they might live 2 months. You ask the doctor, are there any other painkillers? They say, nope, this is it. Okay, so no other painkillers. What's your primary goal? Primary.
Stop the pain.
Stop the pain. It is morally acceptable to give them the painkiller because your primary goal is to ease the pain, not to bump off the patient, right? If you have a choice between two painkillers that are equally good, you choose the one where they live longer, hopefully, but if the only option is one, and there are medicines that do that. They shorten the lifespan. But it's not your intention, certainly not your primary intention to do that. But the taking away of pain is morally acceptable. Even if it's called a principle of double effect, your primary effect is reducing the pain, your secondary effect is a shortening of life. But it's an unintended consequence. But if the other way around is that you are deliberately giving them something that will directly end their life for the sake of ending their life, that goes against commandment number
six.
Anyway, it goes against thou shalt not kill. That's, we can't. Because that's, God said that, don't do that. So we don't do that. But can we continue to provide palliative care, help, pain relief? Because people think that it's stark, right? The Catholic option is stark. No. We don't have to use extraordinary methods to keep someone alive. Okay. I don't have to be attached to 300 machines or even one machine. It's not natural. A natural death is morally acceptable. But I can't directly end their life. If unplugging a machine, which isn't natural, ends their life, that's okay, because they're artificially kept alive anyway. To the best of my knowledge of this issue, if it's artificial, it's artificial, right? And as you know, Catholics don't like artificial things mm-hmm. at the beginning of life and at the end of life. You know. Some people got that. That's good. So that's fine. But where the direct intention is to end the life, that's where we draw the line. We say, well, we are not the masters of life, and so we cannot go there. Because again, the line can get very gray at times. And we see in other countries that have already started with laws on euthanasia, it's gone. The line has moved more and more and more over the time. It's, you know, we're children now. And who consents to this? And how far do you go? And at what point? You know? And the church says, no, we don't play with that at all. We keep working at reducing pain and obviously curing illness. And again, in the Hippocratic Oath, if I remember right, it says, do no harm. Death is harm.
So if they're going to implement a law that allows it, Catholics should be
pissed off.
Pissed off fighting against it.
Yes, they should.
Just a comment.
But the level of apathy is over, well, it's over my head anyway. Mm-hmm. The level of apathy is quite high on that issue, and a lot of issues.
Correct. Because your comment was, are Catholics against euthanasia? Well, that's an interesting thought, because the Catholic Church, we know where the Catholic Church stands, but in discussions with many Catholics, I don't think they, at this point, really agree with that statement, because a lot of them are thinking about it and thinking, well, if it's going to happen to me, and I'm going to die in a short period of time, and it's going to be a lot of pain, I'm not convinced I'm not going to go that route.
I want the easy way out.
Yeah, so the Catholics are needing to understand the issue. But
even the way you're saying it, underneath that is the aversion to pain, which, yeah. One should be averse to, right? Who wants to suffer? But from what the little I've read, and it's not tons and tons, but the little I've read, a lot of pain can be taken away.
I'm just coming directly to your statement, that's all.
But a lot of, because we don't understand the difference between euthanasia and palliative care, we don't understand all of the issues related to that, you know. I have to give a little talk about it tomorrow at the Emmaus prayer group. There, I still have to read about it so I know what I'm saying, because again, I'm not an expert in this whole area, because there are some details that are complicated. But the fundamental principle of it's okay to give people painkillers, absolutely okay. And it's okay that it might shorten their life, you know, and you might be aware that that does. And you might be saying, well, thank God, because then they don't suffer for a whole month. And that's okay too. To say, okay, well, there's a small mercy there, but we can't directly end their life. Like, even for me to think about that, I can't tell you how repugnant it is to me. Like, it's just, like, my mom has Alzheimer's, and there is no way, without me using any swear words, no way, bleepity bleep, would I ever, because again, she can't talk anymore. She's, you know, her situation is send her on her way, right? And in 20, 30 years from now, what will they do? And it just, it sickens me, because this is a human being. Well, it's my mom, right? But it's a human being. And that intrinsic value of life, for us, it's inviolable. It's inviolable. Again, I signed a DNR, because again, bring her back to what? If again, it's natural to, we're going to die, I mean, you can't avoid it, you know? That's fine. That's fine. Death is a natural part of life, from what they tell me. You know? That's normal. We don't have to do all kinds of convoluted things that keep them alive at all costs and break the budget of the, you know, government or whatever. No, that's unnecessary. You know? And I can say, I don't want you spending $1 trillion just for me. That's disproportionate. Other people need help too, right? But for goodness sake, if it hurts, you know, give me, you know, whiskey, give me Demerol, give me something, right? Sure, no problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Several times too, over time, you hear the Catholics who are in that situation where a loved one, parent, is really suffering, so on. And they'll say, is it right or wrong to pray for God to come and get her or him soon? So you're praying for it, but yet you can't do it. You know what I mean? Just to say.
Yeah, because who's the master of life?
Correct.
In our faith? It's God. So he can do it.
It would be no different from you, from a person praying that a mother could get pregnant. Only God makes it, God takes it away. In the way that he chooses, not in the way that we choose. Because we pray for the mother to be pregnant, so yeah, we can pray.
There are some things, apparently, that human involvement helps that, too, from what they tell me.
Some people, Jill,
yes,
have problems.
Yes, I know. But
I think the
only Mary could pray, and that's all she did.
An issue with euthanasia is that it just doesn't stop there. You know, yeah. In some countries, if a teenager loses her boyfriend and she thinks it's the end of the world, she can ask to be put away.
Yeah.
You know, it's just gone totally ridiculous.
Slippery slide.
Mm-hmm. So. They'll push, it's like, well, abortion was the same thing.
You start, well, that's, some people don't like a slippery slope argument. They think it's a bad way to argue things. But when we do look at countries that have begun euthanasia and see the progress, mm-hmm. not progress, but to see the
evolution,
the progression.
Yeah, well, that's still progress, but that's not a good word.
The demolition.
Transition.
But they see the developments that mm-hmm. have happened. You know, they see the changes, the adaptations to that law, because, you know, it's like haggling. Oh, well, what about this case? Oh, okay. And then, it gets reduced. Mm-hmm. And we've lost the line. Mm-hmm. And so the line has to be right up front. Thou shalt not kill.
Yeah.
Human life is sacred. And it doesn't mean that we don't empathize with the suffering of others. We do all in our power to ease the suffering. But to end a life, and then where do we, who, you know, because originally what was it in some jurisdictions was a panel of doctors. And they got rid of that. And then da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And that was, the evidence is there. Mm-hmm. It's not just a slippery slope of an argument that is hypothetical. These are real arguments of real jurisdictions where these really have happened. And it's like, well, at what point do we, this be, you know, and to me, it becomes absurd from the very beginning.
Yeah. And then there's 20% of the cases that don't have paperwork.
Well, no, because, you know.
It reminds me of when you're playing a game, and you're kind of making up the rules as it moves along, like, oh, what? You never thought of that. So, well, just think of it this way, and we'll just do that. And, you know, the game never ends up having to be fun because the rules keep changing and no one's following the correct rules with it.
So, and again, for us as Catholics, the root is the value of life. I think that's based in natural law, also based in divine law. And so when we put that together, it becomes that, you know, that that is a moral imperative. And again, that's a very good hint. But again, it comes to, you opened up a whole evening's talk.
I know.
Yeah, oh yeah.
It was just a question. I don't agree, with euthanasia. It was just a question.
Yeah. All right, well maybe I'll just quit there. And I'll probably try and see what I can dig up for
a list for one
evening to talk about.
About euthanasia by itself.
Yeah. Or maybe combine a few talks.
With abortion in there too. Then.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, let's pray. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Lord our God, we give you thanks for this opportunity to be together. We praise you for each of us who are here. I thank you for helping us to grow in our faith. Help us not only to grow in our minds intellectually, but to grow in our hearts, that we may continue to grow in our love for you and our love for one another. And Lord, we wrap this evening up with the prayer that Jesus taught us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us go in the peace of Christ.
Thank you, Joseph. Thank you very much.